So for pre-test, we have given three questions. The first question was, once a patient has been successfully weaned off from ventilatory support, assessment of airway for the extubation would include all of the following except option A, ability to mobilize secretions, option B, presence of a strong cough, option C, presence of a peritubular leak on cuff deflation, option D, normal breath sounds. So this is the response pattern. 66% believed normal breath sounds is the answer. 24% believed C is the answer. We'll discuss after the lecture. Second question was, if the patient fails a spontaneous breathing trial, the clinician should, option A, determine the causes of failure and correct them when possible. Option B, place the patient on full support and repeat spontaneous breathing trial in 8 hours. C, obtain an arterial blood gas analysis. Option D, switch to artificial intelligence system for weaning. So this is the pattern of response from our attendees. Third question, a patient develops stridor and shortness of breath after extubation. Which of the following is the first appropriate treatment for this problem? Option A, reintubation, 35% favor this. Option B, aerosolized racemic epinephrine, 46% favor this. Only 4% said option C, helium oxygen by non-rebreathing mask. And 15% believe we should start on non-invasive mask ventilation. So this is the background. Basically, pre-test questions are given so that you will know the subject, read and come and prepare and come for the discussion. So we'll discuss about the answers after the session. Chandrasekhar sir, you can start.
My screen is visible.
Your chat screen is also visible.
Not yet.
Fine, it's fine.
It's
Fine.
fine. Okay.
Fine.
Yeah. Good evening, friends. After having gone through the basics and ERDS and COPD ventilation, the other most important aspect is weaning. As you all know that we intubate and place a patient on a ventilator as an organ support system. It's not a treatment for any disease. So the whole idea of intubating and placing somebody is just to buy time so that the primary cause is treated, and in the meantime, his oxygenation is being supported by a ventilator. And ultimately, the goal is to remove the ventilator by weaning. So when we speak of weaning, so the essence of any ventilation when it is initiated has to be terminated at some point of time. So weaning is the most important aspect that you have to look at when you want to be a good doctor in an intensive care handling ventilators. The weaning aspect is very, very important. If you look at the literature, the amount of gray areas are areas with a lot of ambiguity is in weaning, because not surprisingly, not much research has gone into weaning. So what I thought was, in the first day of weaning session, I would be looking at the first two phases of when the patient is acute and when we are stabilizing. For example, in a COVID patient, the stabilization phase may take about 2 to 4 days, and about 2 weeks of stabilization is required. Acute phase is about 2 to 4 days or a week. Then stabilization phase is about 15 days, and the last 1 week would be where you will be testing, readiness testing, and trying to extubate. So the readiness testing and extubation will be what I'll be talking tomorrow. So what is weaning? The process of liberating patients from ventilator is what we call as weaning. And all of you do understand that weaning begins as soon as the patient is intubated by tailoring the setting to the needs of the patient. For example, if you intubate a organ of phosphorus or a snake bite patient, and you are at 100% FiO2, and you bring it down to 40% when you look at the peak and plateau pressures are normal, that means some amount of support has been decreased. Then we say the weaning has started. So weaning doesn't really mean that when you start liberating and thinking of T-piece ventilation and extubation, that is not weaning. Weaning is a process which you have to keep in mind, and it has to be there from the time you place a patient on a ventilator. Rather than weaning, is discontinuation and liberation a better word, is what the literature talks about, because almost 70% of the patients don't require weaning. You can generally go ahead and discontinue the ventilator or liberate the patient from the ventilator the first attempt. So weaning means it's a slow process. So there is it can lead to a misconception. So people do think that discontinuation of mechanical ventilation or liberation of mechanical ventilation would be an appropriate term. But as a precedent, we have been using the term weaning. So it can be used, but you have to remember about 70% of the patient just required to be liberated from the ventilator. Or to look at the other way, it is the transferring of the work of breathing from the ventilator to the patient is what weaning is all about, isn't it? And it is very, very important, because almost 50 to 60% of the time the patient spends on a ventilator is taken up trying to liberate the patient from ventilator. So it becomes the most important thing that you will be doing on a patient, trying to always remove the patient out of the ventilator, isn't it? So weaning is very, very important. So small concepts and issues that we come across weaning has to be understood, so that the outcome is always better with the critically ill patients. So weaning, if you look at weaning, if you delay weaning, what happens? The incidence of nosocomial pneumonia increases, prolonged sedation, neuromuscular blockade, then ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, ICU-acquired weakness, delirium. With all that, it adds up to the cost, and all of us would accept that once the patient crosses about a week, the pressure from the family starts increasing. They lose the trust on the healthcare system. So that is also a factor that we have to always be pressurized to look at. So if you prematurely wean, there is always a fatigue, gas exchange abnormalities. And whenever you go for a premature weaning and extubation, reintubation carries almost 7 to 11 times more risk of death. There is aspiration, atelectasis, and pneumonia. So the thing is, we have to balance it out so well that an optimal weaning, when the patient can withstand weaning to extubation, is what we have to analyze, understand, and make a decision at the bedside. So let us understand some pathophysiology of weaning. See, if you look at the equation of motion for mechanical ventilation, there are two components. This we have been discussing from day one, isn't it? Once the patient, the muscular power of the patient is not capable of managing the blood gases, we generally go and add up a ventilator so that the work is shared between the two. The force that the two systems or the two pumps generate is taken up to overcome the resistance, which is the resistance load, which we calculate by resistance into flow, which is resistance is calculated with the trans airway pressure divided by flow. Plus, once you cross the airways, then you come into, the alveoli. Alveoli, this is called the elastance load. It is the amount of pressure that the volume produces. See, we were talking of compliance. Compliance is nothing but tidal volume divided by driving pressure. Now I put driving pressure divided by tidal volume. This is called elastance. The inverse of compliance is called elastance. It literally means that the amount of pressure in the alveoli, the set tidal volume delivers. This is called the resistive load, and this is called the elastic load. So depending upon our assessment of the patient's capacity to take back the respiratory load, then when we know that the patient is capable of taking some respiratory load, we start the process of weaning. For this, the primary thing that you have to consider is the correction of the primary pathology or the disease for which the patient was put on the ventilator in the first place. So to summarize, what I would say is, there are two people who are sharing the two components which are sharing the work. One is the patient, one is the ventilator. Together, what it has to undergo? It has to undergo, produce a force or a pressure to overcome the resistance and the elastance, and that is the work done by the system. So whenever the patient is not capable of taking up the load, then the ventilator does. At that situation, we can't think of weaning. When the disease process starts correcting, then we tend to transfer the ventilatory assistance to the patient, the weaning process starts. If you look at the control of breathing, there is a respiratory center with output signal, gets into phrenic now, diaphragmatic excitation, contraction, chest wall expansion, airway pressure, flow and volume. Then the ventilator is signaled to start ventilation and start up ventilatory support. What you have to realize in this is there is an inner delay. See, when the signal comes from here to here and we are looking at only the last part, there is a lot of gaps in the assessment that the ventilator does. So ventilator, the information the ventilator gets is at the last part, which is not very appropriate to what the respiratory signal output is there. The ideal would be if you are able to estimate the respiratory center output signals, it would be ideal to assess the weaning. So, but we don't have the technology as of today to assess the respiratory center output signals. There is one mode which takes up the diaphragmatic electrical signals, which is called NAVA. So this is one mode which is much before where the airway pressure drop, flow and volume is to be tackled with. So this is a better mode because it is much closer to the respiratory signal. So I'll explain it to you how it is better in the subsequent slides. So respiratory drive is central to weaning. So you have to understand this, and all of us know the signals go from the chemoreceptors and the mechanoreceptors and some muscle receptors also. And once it goes into the brain, this is the chemical signal. So this is what determines the
sir.
What determines the output and the chest wall? Heard? Hello?
Yeah, in between, we will have to start from the beginning, sir. There was some network issues.
From the first slide?
No, this slide beginning.
Okay, I'll do that. See, respiratory center is the respiratory drive is central to weaning. Once you know the respiratory drive, you can gauge what is the capability of the patient. But the problem is we don't have a system where we can gauge the strength of the respiratory signal, which I have already told. There are some ways where we can look at the respiratory drive. I will tell you in the subsequent slides. But what you have to understand is we don't really know the signal output of the respiratory center. As we know, the signals to the respiratory center are carried by the chemoreceptors and mechanoreceptors, and this is through PCO2, PaO2 and pH, and this gets into the brain and brain produces a signal. And if the signal strength is this big or this big, the breathing signal to the pump, which constitute the inspiratory muscles, the accessory muscles and the most important muscle, the diaphragm and the chest wall, we don't know what is the signal strength. That is one thing you have to analyze, and we have to keep in mind this is one limitation when we are weaning a patient. We don't have the technology right now where we can look at the respiratory drive in the sense that we can measure the output of the brain. So the respiratory drive is nothing but the intensity of the output of the respiratory centers that is appropriate to what the chemical signals it receives from as PCO2, PO2 and pH. And then it determines the mechanical output of the respiratory muscles. That is what we call as the breathing effort. If you interestingly look at a COVID situation, here in COVID situation, the point is the lung is normal. And the breathing effort, if the lung is not normal, then the volume that gets into the lung is small. Just as the problem is on the vascular side of the pathology, the patient is going to draw a lot of air, and that leads to what we call as PC leak. So that is one thing you have to remember here, that the respiratory drive is very huge because of high fever and neurotropism, that the COVID goes and acts into the brain, and the respiratory drive is as big as this orange, and the lung is normal. It can accommodate a huge tidal volume. And once the accommodation of the tidal volume is appropriate to what the brain thinks, the patient doesn't have dyspnea. If the lung is stiff, like in ARDS, and if the amount of volume that the brain anticipates is not taken in, then the dyspnea sets in. So that is one thing that you have to remember. If the patient doesn't have dyspnea, he delays the hospital, coming to the hospital. And as doctors, we also, when you ask the patient says that, I am all right, because the pathology is in the vascular side. Just because I'm talking of this, I want you to understand that at that point, if you are trying to put a patient on a ventilator, it is to decrease this breathing respiratory drive. With sedation, if you cannot decrease, and the only way you can avoid PCLE is by intubation and putting him on sedation and neuromuscular blockade. So the bottom line that you have to remember, or the take home of this slide, would be there is a respiratory breathing effort is translated into tidal volume, respiratory rate, and workup breathing. So we don't have the means of estimating either the respiratory breathing effort or the respiratory drive. We tend to work only with respiratory rate, tidal volume, and workup breathing. So this is one more limitation you have to keep in mind when you are looking at weaning. But there are some means in modern day ventilators where you can look at the respiratory drive and breathing effort to a large extent. I will show you in my subsequent slides. So irrespective of the muscle capability, a high respiratory drive is very, very important to be noticed, because this leads to a lot of problems onto the breathing system or to the pump, which leads to ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction and weaning failure. So why there is a high respiratory drive? There may be a lot of catabolism which is not being addressed, like a cytokine storm or an unresolved pathology. Whenever there is a high respiratory drive, you should think that there is a high catabolic demand and an unresolved pathology. So what it does is, as I said, PCLE, diaphragmatic injury, asynchronous, flow starvation, too much of effort leading to early cycling, double triggering, and SBT failure and extubation failure can occur. This is irrespective of the capability of the pump, the muscular pump, constituting of diaphragm, chest wall, and the inspiratory muscles. A high respiratory drive is a problem and can lead to extubation failure and also to injury to the lung. This is what you have to remember. So this leads to ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. Excessive drive and a decreased respiratory muscle strength is a more troublesome problem, isn't it? One, there is a drive pump, one center which is trying to ask the muscles to pump more, and the muscles are not capable. Then that definitely leads to weaning failure. So what you have to understand is there is a respiratory drive and there are muscles who have to take the command from the respiratory drive and work appropriately. If there is a problem in one system, also weaning failure is possible, and if both the systems are affected, the chances of weaning failure are much more. If there is a low respiratory drive, possibly because of sedation, when we in the acute phase where we in ARDS, COPD, first 24 to 48 hours, when we put, the drive can be suppressed. There is septic encephalopathy, sometimes in delirium, hypoplastic deniriums also, there can be a low respiratory drive. This leads to hypoventilation, controlled ventilation, disused atrophy of the diaphragm, asynchronous, reverse triggering, and again extubation failure. This also leads to ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. This is irrespective of the capabilities of the pump I'm talking. As I have said earlier, if it is combined with the pump, then we have more trouble. And a respiratory drive which is very high can definitely lead to a pump problem also, by putting a injury to the ventilator diaphragm, which takes up almost 80 to 90%. It's the major inspiratory muscle, isn't it? It takes up in a normal breathing up to 90% of the inspiratory effort. It is what contributes to 90% of the effort. So both a high and low inspiratory drive, irrespective of the muscle strength, can cause muscle damage. That is the take-home message. As I've said, respiratory drive is the central controller. There is something called P01. I'll be discussing it tomorrow, where we can assess the respiratory drive. It is available in all ventilators. It doesn't require anything. You just press up a button. It fairly tells you what is the respiratory drive. We'll discuss it tomorrow. And as I said, input sensors are ABG, PaO2s, PCO2s and pH, which we can get from a ABG. Stretch on the lung and the chest wall can be got from transpulmonary pressures and FRC. These are available on some ventilators. If you don't have, the surrogates are PPLAT and driving pressures, which we have discussed in detail. And when the input gets into the respiratory center, this produces an output to the pump. And here you can assess the respiratory muscle strength by looking at the diaphragmatic electrical signals by putting a gastric balloon and a pleural pressure. But if all these are not available, the only thing that most of us look at is tidal volume, respiratory rate, and workup breathing. What you have to understand is these three parameters which we look at are not very accurate. So whenever a ventilator has a capability, it is better to look at some of these parameters and the respiratory drive parameter at P01. Most of them are available on ventilators. I will tell you in some today and some tomorrow what are the values, how to look at and how to make a decision whether it is good or bad, what is the normal cutoff values. So what I want you to understand is the input sensors gives us the demand. What is the demand that the respiratory drive is getting? And what is the output? Is the output matching this? This is what, by looking at all this, you will have to judge and make a decision whether the patient is capable of taking up the load and get into weaning phase and going into a readiness testing. And if he passes, going into extubation. This is the whole situation that you have to analyze looking at this information. This is the concept that I want you to understand. As I've said, if both are equal, weaning occurs. If there is an imbalance, then the trouble starts. If the imbalance is both on the respiratory drive side and the respiratory muscle strength side, then weaning success becomes very, very less. As I've said, this is what you look at, and this is what you look at for the respiratory muscle strength. This pressure muscle index and P01 for the respiratory drive is available on all ventilators. You can generally look at both of them and make somewhat a more scientific decision about the capability of the patient to undergo weaning. These two parameters I'll be discussing today, tomorrow, but mostly I'll be looking at the acute and the stabilization phase weaning today. As I've said, respiratory rate, tidal volume, and workup breathing can be influenced by resistance, compliance, chest wall, pain, anxiety, and fever. So these are not very accurate. Though in most cases, these are the things that we tend to depend upon in a modern day ventilators with the kind of knowledge that we have and the research that the ventilator is able to produce ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. I feel P01 and the PPLATs in a pressure support ventilation are two most important parameters that you have to look at for weaning. As I've said, these are the things you have to see. And another thing what you have to understand here is the electrical signals of the diaphragm is what NAVA uses, and workup breathing and pressure time product is what the proportional assist ventilation uses, and these are called proportional modes. You remember that. I will tell you what it exactly means in my subsequent talk. These are available in all ventilators and can be applied, and it makes weaning more evidence based or based on some assessment of respiratory drive and the measure the pump strength. See, by looking at these two parameters, you are gauging the weaning capabilities, looking at the respiratory drive and capable, what is the output and is it more, less, or is it normal? And second thing is, how well is the pump? So once you know how to analyze that information, then weaning becomes more scientific. So can ventilator modulate the respiratory drive? Yes, it can modulate by putting in inspiratory assist and PEEP. And once it alters your PaO2, PCO2 and pH and the mechanical deformation of P plates and driving pressure, as I have said, which are surrogates, and we have discussed extensively that it has to be less than 28 to 30 plateau pressures and driving pressures less than 15, can alter the respiratory drive. So once these are decreased, if your PaO2 increases, PCO2 decreases and the pH is normalized, the respiratory drive comes down. That happens with an inspiratory assist and a PEEP. So titrating the level of inspiratory support to obtain an adequate respiratory drive and breathing effort is the goal. If at all you add up too much of PEEP, if you add too much of PEEP, then the trouble comes in the sense that it can cause a lot of compression to your diaphragm and produce ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. So as I've said, it can modulate in a positive way, it can modulate in the negative way. So we have to understand and learn how the inspiratory assist and PEEP has to be used in such a way that it only does a decrease in the respiratory drive without producing any problem to the diaphragm. If this doesn't respond, if the change in this doesn't bring down the respiratory drive, then are your P01, what you have to think is there is some irritant receptors in the thorax, like infected pleural effusion or agitation, pain, anxiety or intracerebral pathologies have to be considered in a situation where after correction of AABG, still if the respiratory drive is not settling down, then you have to consider these factors. And this also can be modified with addition of sedation. So the ideal situation would be if the ventilator is looped to the neural signal from the respiratory center and produces a tidal volume and respiratory rate, which keeps the PCO2, PO2 and pH in a normal range, that would be the ideal situation. But as I've said, we don't have that technology. If that is possible in next few years, then there won't be any asynchronous, because the neural inspiratory time will be equal to the ventilatory inspiratory time and neural expiratory time would be equal to the ventilatory expiratory time. This is, if this happens, we can say your mechanical ventilator is producing a ventilation, which is what the brain wants. But only two modes which can produce something very close to this is, one is NAVA, one is proportional assist ventilation. I will show some details about NAVA, but we will discuss about the proportional assist ventilation when I discuss about the advanced modes after 2 weeks. So classification of weaning, as I've said, there are two components to the taking up of the work of breathing. And we have discussed that once the patient is capable to take up some amount of work, we think of weaning. So one is, and always the goal of weaning is for extubation. So the phases is acute phase, then we come into stabilization phase, then readiness testing. The shift over from stabilization phase to readiness is always, you have to be suspicious every day. Studies have proved that this is the area where a lot of time is wasted. People don't have the suspicion that patient is ready for readiness testing and extubation. We will discuss that tomorrow, how we can improve our suspicion that patient is ready for testing and extubation. But the whole day's lecture would be discussing about how to shorten the acute phase, and if at all if the patient is in the acute phase, what we can do to protect our diaphragm or prevent the other complications, and in the stabilization phase, how to keep the weaning modes going and keeping the patient fit for readiness testing. See, if you don't handle the patient on a ventilator properly here with other good supportive care, then the problem comes that the readiness testing, when you shift the patient to readiness testing, there are some pathologies that you induce during this phase because of the disease process and because of the supportive care when not given properly, then the patients don't wean very comfortably or easily. So the phase of maintaining the ventilation in this phase is very, very important for shifting the patient for readiness testing and extubation. Readiness testing depend, there are two components. One is measuring weaning predictors and doing weaning trials and going for extubation. And extubation will compromise of extubation success or failure. And success may be with NIV or HFNO. And failure, if it, failure occurs, we may have to intubate and go for a stabilization phase. As I've said, the phases, the length of the phases depends upon the diseases. See, if you look at a organophosphorus poisoning patient, the acute phase may be few hours. If you look at a ARDS patient, pneumonia, it may be about 4 days. If you look at a COVID patient, it may be a week. So the phases, the length of the phases depends upon the patient condition, comorbidities, and also the disease process. That also you have to factor in when you look at the stages of weaning. It doesn't, the one size doesn't fit all. So you can't say acute phase lasts for 2 days, 3 days. It depends upon definitely on the primary pathology and the patient condition. So why stabilization phase is important? Because if you don't do this phase properly, then when you go for this phase of extubation, when you are jumping, if you are not having a parachute, or not if you have not taken instruction of not how to get the parachute out, then the consequences will be disastrous, isn't it? The same thing happens that if you don't maintain the patient very well in these two phases, acute phase and stabilization phase, then the extubation doesn't occur the way you would expect. So my whole next 10-15 half an hour of my lecture would be how to minimize the impact of the ventilator or the pathology and what we can do to keep the patient fit for the final gem or the extubation. So weaning is classified as simple weaning, where on the first attempt the readiness testing is done and you extubate. And you look at here, almost 70% of the patients don't require any effort at all. And the mortality is very, very low. These are the patients we see most of the time. Then these are the ARDS, COPDs, where three SBTs are as long as 7 days from the first SBT to achieve the weaning. The mortality goes up. This prolonged weaning is with acute illness. Most of them are elderly with lot of comorbidities. These are the patients who have a fixed disease, the components like a heart disease, a respiratory cripple, where we don't have the capability to alter the primary pathology. These are the patients who go into prolonged weaning. These are the, they take more than 7 days after the first SPT, and the mortality obviously has to be much more. And sometimes these prolonged weaning patients in Western setups are shifted to exclusive weaning centers. The problem with us in our country is we don't have anything called a specialized weaning center. So we tend to get entangled with these patients, and with the cost going up, there will be a lot of pressure and a lot of problems when handling these patients. These are a special set of patients, and especially if you don't maintain the acute and stabilization phase very well, the prolonged weaning patient may be very, very difficult to wean when most of them don't come out of the ventilator. So it becomes all the more important to make the difficult weaning and the prolonged weaning group more safer, that you have to understand what you have to do in the acute and stabilization phase so that the weaning becomes easier. And there is a lot of misconception that weaning is just by turning a few buttons, like doing a good SPT, doing a very gradual weaning of pressure support, the patient will be weaned. You come out from that concept. Weaning doesn't depend on what you do with the ventilator, but depends upon how well you have maintained the patient in the acute phase and the stabilization phase. adding to that, there are some patients, because of the pathology, we can't do much. But that is because of the disease process. They are dysregulated immune system, not responding to treatment. Patient becomes bad and dies. Yes, we tend to lose a set of patients. But patients who are going to survive, if they are managed well during the acute phase and the stabilization phase, wean easy. So you always remember, weaning doesn't depend on what you do with the ventilator, but on the overall well-being of the patient. So in the acute phase, what can we do? See, we do understand, as I've said, the acute phase, the length of the acute phase depends upon the disease states and the patient condition. And here, we do understand that in sick patients like ARDS and say COPD, there may be an neuromuscular blockers and sedation, uncontrolled modes, high dose of vasopressors. When they are hypotensive and high dose, we don't tend to give nutrition. So they are kept NPO. These are the patients who are high risk for ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. This is ICU, acquired weakness, and delirium. This is a triad that you have to manage in that phase. Once you tend to mitigate the effects of this or avoid this totally, the weaning success becomes more. So the next 10-15 minutes would be how to mitigate the effects of ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, ICU-acquired weakness, and delirium. In the acute phase, as I've said, there is expiratory myotrauma because of IP. That is the reason why the trend is to go in for a moderate PEEP. We are looking at a lung protective ventilation. The concept now is diaphragmatic protective ventilation. You put a PEEP more than 15, 20, 25, then the expiratory myotrauma occurs, because diaphragm is mated at a shortened end expiratory length for a prolonged period of time. There is atrophy because of sacromal dropout and longitudinal atrophy. This we call it as expiratory myotrauma. And once you remove PEEP, after having kept the PEEP for 5-6 days, then the diaphragm goes into atrophy and it doesn't have the capability to produce the effective inspiratory pull. So the patient become very difficult to wean. So you have to understand, a moderation of PEEP is not just for lung protective ventilation, but it's also for diaphragmatic protection. So the treatment in this aspect would be to stop the relaxants as soon as possible. What is recommended is 24 to 48 hours, but the recent trial said that relaxants may not be, the mortality benefit was not there. If you are capable of managing by keeping the respiratory drive low with sedation, I would advise that you don't give neuromuscular blockades, then moderation of PEEP, and always try to set the nutrition back within 24 hours. I heard the talk on nutrition by Dr. Anoop. So he has extensively covered, and you know why nutrition is important. So we'll just keep the nutrition to saying that nutrition is important to prevent the diaphragmatic dysfunction. So which mode of weaning in this phase? Once the patient becomes little better, like say ARDS patient, day 4, stable hemodynamics, stable blood gases, neuromuscular blockage stops, sedation weaned. So we generally go with a pressure modes, like a pressure control mode or a BiPAP. As I've said, the pressurization in a pressure mode from after triggering is more helpful to the patient rather than keeping him on assist volume control, because it's a fixed flow. So patient will have a lot of asynchronous. And even if you put at a adaptive support ventilation, it is nothing but a alteration between pressure control and pressure support breaths. So pressure modes are better once the patient is started, when he gets into assist kind of a situation where only he can trigger, but the limiting and cycling is controlled by the patient. It is better to go with pressure mode, because the pressurization or the flow is more conducive or mimics the normal breathing. On day 5, patient is better. It is always pressure support we use. If you use proportional assist ventilation or a volume support or a NAVA, it is all a modification or some modification of pressure support. So that is the reason why I have been insisting that you should know how to use pressure support ventilation, because if you analyze now, almost 50 to 60% of the time a patient spends on the ventilator would be on pressure support ventilation. See, these are the two studies which are very old. It's in 1994, one study which said that SMV is bad for weaning. There are some pros and cons. I don't want to go into the details because a very old study, a lot of research has gone. We have learned so many other things now. And this study also didn't produce any great results for SMV. So the bottom line is, we don't use SMV for weaning. This we have discussed. In fact, we have said we don't use SMV at all because we know there is a lot of asynchrony problems and also diaphragmatic injury, which I will show in the next slide. So what you have to understand is there is science which says that diaphragm is injured because of SMV, and studies also have proved during weaning SMV doesn't score over pressure support or the T-tube. So we don't use SMV. We use a pressure control or adaptive support ventilation or a bilevel ventilation, but not a SMV with pressure control or volume control ventilation. This slide you have all seen. See, look at here. The patient is going into a mandatory breath. These are two pressure supported breaths. Here, the inspiratory time is controlled with the brain, where 1 second, 2 seconds, suddenly, then the patient has to accommodate a ventilation, which is 2 seconds and 4 seconds. And another thing what you have to realize here is the diaphragm is not going to stop here. The diaphragm is going to contract. How will the diaphragm know that it's going to get a mandatory breath and stop pulling the air in? It's not going to do. So what happens is, see, the patient is trying to push the air out because he has finished the expiration here, and the ventilator is pushing the air in. The patient is trying to push the air out because he's in the expiratory phase, because he was on the expiratory phase all the time, and his brain is having an inspiratory time of 1 second, and suddenly you have made it into 2 seconds. So this goes into what we call as a pleiotropic diaphragmatic injury or a eccentric kind of a diaphragmatic injury, and it also leads to a lot of asynchrony. This is the reason or the science behind the SMV usage. And just because it causes also a diaphragmatic injury along with asynchrony, and there is no decrease in the work of breathing because of a mandatory breath, because the diaphragm is going to contract, we are saying that don't use SMV as a ventilatory mode and also as a weaning mode. So stabilization phase, as I've said, again depends upon the disease state and the patient condition. It definitely is not same for every disease. As I've said, for a COVID or a organophosphorus poisoning, it differs. See, always in the stabilization phase, the patient is on pressure support mode with or some modification of pressure support ventilation. As I've said, BiPAP is nothing but pressure control with pressure support. Volume support is pressure support for a targeted volume. Pressure support is promote is obviously pressure support. Then smart care is pressure support. Nava is pressure support attached to the electrical activity of the diaphragm. So it's all some modification of pressure support or plain pressure support ventilation is what we use in stabilization mode. So this can lead to under-resistance myotrauma or over-resistance myotrauma. One thing you can remember is any heart respiratory rate of less than 70 in a patient who is being weaned, you should always consider that the pressure support that you have set in is much more than what the pressure patient requires. There is a lot of studies which have narrowed down. It's a very good indicator that if the respiratory rate is less than 17 to 15, when you are weaning, you should anticipate that there is over-resistance, and of course, asynchrony is an issue with pressure support. This is what I'm looking at, pressure support. A pressure support ventilation can lead to under-resistance myotrauma, over-resistance myotrauma, or asynchrony. So how do you correct in this phase? Correction is, as I've said, primary cause, nutrition, physical and occupational therapy, very, very important. This is one thing which prevents VIDI and ICU acquired weakness. I will show you some slides how it is done. Then you have to promote sleep and prevent delirium. So the first concept here is, when you are in a weaning phase, you are on pressure support ventilation, the three things that you have to prevent is or minimize is delirium, ICU acquired weakness, a ventilator dysfunction may be a part of this, or a ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, and two is, and this is what makes the weaning successful. If you are capable of mitigating the effects of delirium, ICU acquired weakness and ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, the weaning success will be more. And two is, on the ventilator, what can we do to prevent the ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction is what is the discourse in the next 10-15 minutes. So the next 10-15 minutes, as we understand that the patient is on a stabilization phase and is on a pressure support mode, the only three things we have to mitigate is delirium, ICU acquired weakness and ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction to increase the weaning success, and what we can do with the pressure support to cut down the over assistance, under assistance or asynchronous, which lead to VIDI with the discourse or the narration in the next 10-15 minutes. You look at this scenario, a 55-year-old admitted with a community acquired pneumonia, diabetes mellitus, IHD, respiratory failure, placed on ventilator, ARDS, ejection fraction of 30%, takes 2 weeks to ARDS to resolve, was on sedatives and neuromuscular blockers for 2 to 3 days. After 2 weeks, repeated attempts, we are finding it difficult to wean this guy. What are the factors we have to consider now? One is, it could be unresolved ARDS, cardiac insufficiency, then critical care induced weakness, ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. As I have said, sedation and paralysis can lead to diaphragmatic atrophy, and then nutrition may be compromised, and it can be small contribution from all this. So it can be multifactorial. This is patient factors, this is acquired factors. What I'm trying to tell you is, these factors, acquired factors, have to be minimized. The effects have to be mitigated to produce more weaning success. That's the take-home message. Now, you have to treat the correctable factors and optimize the chronic medical condition. And this is only thing that you can do is, once it occurs, at the end, when you are trying to do an extubation, you can't do much. There won't be much you can do with, if already the patient has critical care induced weakness or acquired weakness or a ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, malnutrition, nothing much can be done. So the whole goal is for prevention of all these three, so that weaning becomes more successful. As I've said, it is not just what you do on the ventilator, how you manage the patient is what matters in weaning. As I've said, these three factors, and if you look at all these three factors, have a common in being more in elderly patients, sick patients with multi-organ dysfunction, with more longer the duration, more the chances of the triad, and ARDS and COPD is much more. And these are the contributory factors for all the three, and along with asynchrony and mechanical ventilation. And the treatment is only prevention. As I've said, it's only prevention, nothing much treatment-wise to do. Sorry. So it is gentle ventilation, physical and occupational therapy, and good supportive care with nutrition is the whole thing that you can do. There is no specific treatment for delirium. There is no specific treatment for ICU acquired weakness and ventilator induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. If you have ventilated badly and it has gone into VIDD, nothing much can be done. So the whole goal is to prevent. So this bundle, I think there was a lecture on bundles also. Anup told me that this lecture has happened. So it is very important, ABCDF bundle. This bundle everybody has to implement. This is what prevents the weaning problems during the readiness testing and extubation. When you do this bundle properly, then the patients do wean and extubate very easily. So A, B is awakening and breathing coordination. So then C is for choosing light sedation and avoiding benzodiazepines. D is delirium monitoring and management. E is early mobility, exercise and occupational therapy. F is nutrition, which is feeding, and family engagement. This is very, very important. I urge all of you to implement this bundle in the ICU. This is what makes the weaning successful. nutritional management, as there was a lecture about last week, so I'll not go into depth of it. Decreased ventilatory response to hypoxia, decreased muscle mass and thickness, decrease in the muscle strength and endurance. So one slide, how to treat, start early, as early as possible, good glycemic control, and don't consider protein as calories, good fluid and electrolyte management, enteral nutrition, use the gut whenever it works, electrolytes and trace elements, as I said. A stitch in time saves 9 is what we generally say, but in nutrition therapy, if you leave it late, then it may be difficult to identify where to put the stitch. That is the bottom line. Nutrition is something which cannot be corrected acutely. If you look at an albumin of 1.5, give a 100 ml, 20% albumin, it is not going to correct your malnutrition. That is what you have to remember. Most of the surgeons think that it happens that way, but it doesn't. You have to build up the proteins, increase the production of the albumin. That takes time. And that takes time, and the time is sometimes weeks. Delirium management, a acute confusional state where there is a fluctuating mental status, disordered attention, and disorganized thinking and altered consciousness. It's a brain's way of demonstrating acute organ dysfunction. And there are three types, hyperacute, mixed. This is easy to identify. And almost about 50% are hypoacute. It looks like somebody has undergone a stroke. And we do a lot of MR, CTs, LPs, and in the end, we say that it is a hypoactive delirium. And it is a diagnosis out of exclusion. That is the problem. So you have to be cognizant to the fact that any patient who is suddenly not responding could be a hypoactive delirium. And this is the scale, which very, very easy. This can be implemented in all ICUs, and nurses can be trained. And every shift twice, somebody has to look at this scale. It's very easy. It can be implemented in most of the ICUs. So why delirium matters to us? Because it increases the ICU stay and hospital stay. Each day in delirium increases the stay by 20%. Mortality is increased, and mortality increases even after the patient are discharged. And the hospital and ICU cost also goes up. So delirium management is very, very important. You have to know how to identify it, and at least if not, to minimize, mitigate the effects of delirium. There is no drugs have been recommended for delirium. Haloperidol, what we used to give, has been removed in the recent guidelines. Midazolam is known to cause. So the midazolam should not be frequently used in ICU. Even ventilated patients, they have recommended dexmetidomidine, and propofol would be a better option than midazolam. And non-pharmacological interventions like light cancellation, noise cancellation, minimizing isolation, and cognitive therapy is what is being advocated to mitigate the delirium, effects of the delirium. Then next two slides about ICU-acquired weakness and ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. In a literature survey, Tobin found that whenever there was a weaning difficulty, it was mostly common, mostly because of the diaphragm and the excess. He analyzed and said that it is always because of the failure of the respiratory muscle pump. So the two contributors for this are ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction and ICU-acquired weakness, which lead to the respiratory muscle pump being less efficient. So we have to minimize. Sometimes it is not possible. In a very severe ARDS, PEEPs have to be kept at 50. But when you are ventilating with a PEEP of 20, 25, you should be aware that this may cause a ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, and that may lead to weaning difficulties. So critical illness, malnutrition, and protein catabolism, cytokines, and reactive oxygen species, with this being there with bed rest, all lead to neuromuscular damage. All these are there, isn't it? In a critically ill patient, when the patient is on ventilator with critical illness, especially sepsis, then the chances of ICU-acquired illness doubles. That is what you have to remember. Then it leads to muscle wasting and an ineffective pump, leads to increased ICU stay, hospital stay, increased and prolonged time on ventilator, and decreased ability and quality of life. This is what happens. This doesn't stop with the ventilation. It becomes difficult to wean. And once the patient gets out, also the quality of life, the functional quality of life is decreased. So incidence is about 25 to 65% within 5 days. And recent evidence suggests that in humans, the primary promoting factor is disused muscle atrophy and decrease in protein synthesis. As I've said, when mechanical ventilation and critical illness with sepsis occurs, then the chances of ICU-acquired illness is much more. This is the triad of ICU-acquired weakness, polyneuropathy, myopathy, and neuromuscular pathology. And the physical findings is there is a relative preservation of cranial nerves, symmetrical involvement, usually sparing the facial muscles, reduced or absent tendon muscles, weakening of the diaphragm, and loss of peripheral sensation to light, touch, and pin pick. At bedside, there are few things that you can make to evaluate the ICU-acquired. Though ICU-acquired weakness is a diagnosis out of exclusion, some clinical signs should be whenever you find somebody struggling to be weaned, you should always consider it as a factor. And patient with a profound weakness despite return of sensorium that causes quadriplegia, then you have to consider this. And this is a very, very important clue. That early clue is a painful pressure in the nail beds. So limited to absent limb responses. He doesn't push or pull his limb, but yet there is a normal grimacing. This is one sign that you can evaluate at the bedside and then try to think that this diagnosis is possible, that the patient may have ICU acquired weakness. And this is the testing we do. This is the manual muscle testing, ENMG and muscle or nerve biopsy. And the treatment is nothing but a good supportive care with early mobility. And these are the causes which we have already discussed. Between ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction and ICU-acquired, which is more troublesome to us? See, there was a recent publication into 2020 in the Annals of Intensive Care where they proved that if somebody has a diaphragmatic dysfunction or ICU-acquired weakness, then the survival chances are low. Between the two, they found that ICU-acquired weakness causes more injury to the patient, and they have a less chance of survival. They have a less chance of between ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction and ICU-acquired weakness. ICU-acquired weakness is more causes more injury to the patient and becomes more difficult. So the mortality goes up. This is what the study published in 2020 says. So now we go in for a diaphragmatic protective ventilation. What are we talking of diaphragmatic protective ventilation? I have said controlled ventilation causes diaphragmatic atrophy and it happens very early. So in fact, within 5, 6, 8 hours, it will be there. Within 18 to 24 hours, it's fully set. So moderate PEEP, then avoid over-assistance, under-assistance, avoid asynchronous, early weaning and extubation. If you do all this, it leads to diaphragmatic protective ventilation. And you should remember that diaphragm is not a biologically inert organ that can be lightheartedly substituted by a ventilator. This vital pump is both malleable and vulnerable. So the diaphragmatic structural injury and atrophy occurs, leading to reduction in the diaphragmatic force generating capacity. So some ventilatory things that we induce, like putting him on a controlled ventilation, giving a lot of high PEEPs, then a lot of asynchronous lead to this. So this is what we have to avoid. And in the next 2-3 slides, let us see how we can do a good ventilation on a pressure support ventilation and mitigate the effects of ventilator producing into VIDD. So it's always the muscle capacity, which is because of atrophy, inactivity and myopathy, and the workload, what we have to do is this: optimize the muscular loading, use good modes, avoid asynchronous, and progressive workload training, which I'll show you how it is done. So this is the asynchronous which we are looking at. As I've said that there are three phases: trigger phase, so there may be trigger asynchrony, pressurization phase, pressurization asynchrony. As I said, in volume control, there is a lot of fixed flow, but pressure control is better. This is the level of assistance that can be under-assisted or over-assisted, and then cycling asynchrony. And sometimes the asynchrony carries on to the next breath. So this is something which we can avoid by setting the pressure support ventilation appropriate to the patient's requirement, looking at the cycling and then triggering things, which we will discuss in the next 2-3 slides. And when the patient has a diaphragmatic thickening because of lot of pulling, when you under assist or over assist a patient, the diaphragm starts working and it becomes thickened. So whenever the ventilator was thickened, when the increase was more than 10% which was not thickened, the patients who had a ventilator thickening, the survival chances and the liberation chances were very, very low. And this figure also shows that when the optimal thickness is there, then the weaning chances and the survival chances are much better. And you can do a diaphragmatic ultrasound. One is subcostal and one is intercostal. And you can look at the with this subcostal, you can do a M mode. And with this, you can look at the thickness and the inspiratory intrusion. As the probe and the diaphragm is moving towards the probe, you always get a positive reflection. And there are values. You can look into this. I think there was a class done on ultrasound in our a webinar classroom. I think this part is covered. I'll not go into detail. But one factor of thickness when you are considering in a sick patient, always factor in the tissue edema. Sometimes tissue edema may give a wrong result. Asynchrony also leads to a lot of injury, breath stacking, alkalosis, and then worsening of mechanical sleep fragmentation, longer stay, and can confuse the clinician. So asynchrony also is a factor that you have to consider. And this is only one I have put asynchrony. This is a topic on its own. See, here the neural time is here. Patient is trying to want to change from inspiration to expiration here. Your expiratory sensitivity is set here. So patient will tend to contract here. So the patient will go in for a delayed cycling, missed breath, and by shifting the expiratory sensitivity up, probably you will make the patient synchronize better. Here the the patient neurologically wants to end here, but the ventilator is ending here and still may contract and go in for double triggering. Here again, the expiratory trigger sensitivity has to be increased. This is what you have to analyze looking at the graphics and try to do this to prevent the ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. Next, physical therapy and occupational therapy is two things which are very, very important, which can mitigate the effects of ICU-acquired weakness and also the ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction. So it can be done on passive patients on the bed itself, like cycling. Some lady is doing a cycling here. She is doing the lower limb physiotherapy and strengthening exercises here. You would notice here. So this is inspiratory muscle training. This is some kind of a threshold device. It is available on Amazon for about 4,000 rupees. Once you connect and put it to this, this is like a pee valve. Once you increase, say 5 centimeters, 10 centimeters, you ask the patient to breathe. And once he starts increasing his inspiratory capacity, you can slowly increase the resistance so that patient gets trained. There are some studies which say that once you do inspiratory muscle training, the chances of weaning becomes more. It is available on Amazon website for about 3,900 rupees. You can buy this. It's a good thing to have, especially in cancer patients, in elderly patients, COPD patients, where you can do inspiratory muscle training. And this can be used for pre-op training also. And this is passive physical therapy. Patients have to be hemodynamically stable. Gases have to be stable. Neurologically, he has to be stable. You can do passive therapy for unconscious patients, positioning, tilting the arms, supported, unsupported, sitting on the edge of the bed, chair sitting and walking can be done. This decreases the length of stay and hospitalization. This is something I would urge all of you to implement in the ICU. This is the job of the respiratory therapist and the physiotherapist. This is something you have to talk to them and impress upon them that this is what matters for weaning at the later stage. Sleep and weaning. Sleep is important. When the sleep is not adequate, it leads to loss of defense mechanism, loss of respiratory muscle strength, and delirium and delayed weaning. And another important thing is, this is very common. If the patient is over-assisted on a pressure support ventilation because of increased tidal volumes, his PCO2 falls, and there is a threshold. When you are awake, the threshold is not there. Even if you come to 10, you don't have the suddenly a sense of getting a deep breath. But when you are asleep, the curve stops here. When the PCO2 decreases beyond around 30, 37, 38, the patient wakes up. There is arousals. This may decrease the quality of sleep and leads to sleep fragmentation. Look at here, when a pressure support of 14, there is a lot of arousals. When we go to 10, it is decreased. Then 8 and 6, it is completely decreased. So at 8 also, maybe because of under assistance, it is there. So ideally, this patient should be in a pressure support of around 8 to 10. This is how, if you do sleep studies, you get. But whenever you notice that, looking at the trend, the tidal volumes have been shifting and patient has been having increased and decreased variability in tidal volume, probably you should analyze that the patient was over-assisted. As I've said, if the respiratory rate is less than 15, you probably should think in all patients that there is some amount of over-assistance. Again, it is light and noise control is what we advise for sleep. Next two, three slides is pressure support a good mode? See, what happens with pressure support is, you look at here, the patient is having a esophageal pressure swings. If you think that this 10 centimeters of water is adequate, if the patient becomes like this because suddenly somebody gives him a sedation, he was having fever, he was anxious, again the pressure support doesn't change. And if the patient starts pulling more, then also the pressure support doesn't change. Here he may be over-assisted, here he may be under-assisted. There is no change. Once you set a pressure support, the pressure support goes irrespective of what the diaphragm does or what the diaphragm wants or what the brain wants. This is a limitation with pressure support. This happens in a small fragment of patients. Most of the patients do well on pressure support. But when you tend to feel that some patients are difficult to wean on pressure support, probably you should think of over-assistance and under-assistance. So are there any modes which is a modification of pressure support which do better work than pressure support? Let us see. There is one mode called as volume support. In this mode, what we do is we tell the ventilator we want a tidal volume of 400. We fix the volume of 400. Then we tell the ventilator it can work at a pressure of 25 centimeters pressure. Then it has the capability of changing from 0 to 20 or a minimum of 5 to 20 centimeters. What we set it as 30, less than that is the range where it can work. From 5 to 20, it can alter. So it tries to give a test breath with 5 centimeters, then 8 centimeters, 10 centimeters. If somebody gets a tidal volume of 400 or 10 centimeters, it stops at that. If somebody doesn't, then it goes to 15, 20. And at 20 also, if you are not able to achieve 40 centimeters, it gives an alarm. So this is a small modification of pressure support ventilation. You see here, it was 250 at 8 centimeters, then at 340 at 10, at 12 centimeters, it achieved 400 tidal volume. But we had given a pressure range of 25 to the ventilator, and ventilator allows 5 less than that, so till 20. But the patient is at 12. It achieved. Now the patient starts increasing the capability of his diaphragm, then he goes at 12 to 450, then it starts decreasing. This is how pressure volume support works. It's a slight better modification of pressure support ventilation. If it is available, I would advise you can go with a volume support ventilation rather than a pressure support ventilation. It's nothing but a pressure support set for a set tidal volume to be delivered. Is it 100% good? Let us see. See here, now, if the assistance is normal, it works very well. I want 400 and it is getting 400, it is doing well. If the assistance is low, probably it will increase the assistance till from 8, 10, 12, till 20, and it tries to maintain 400, it does well. There is no problem. But if there is over assistance, what happens with this mode is, if it starts getting 500, 500 for the set pressure, but we want only 400, it starts decreasing the pressure support. You see here, it starts decreasing the pressure support. I want 600. See, there is a inspiratory signal saying that I want a large tidal volume. I want a large tidal volume, but because the set tidal volume was 400, with this tidal volume, for maybe at 8 pressure or 10 pressure support, I achieved a tidal volume of 400, it starts decreasing. There is a negative feedback. So volume support works very well when there is when the diaphragm is not contracting very much, or it is adequately contracting. When the respiratory drive is very high, and if there is a very huge demand, because of the negative feedback, it starts decreasing the pressure support. This is one disadvantage of the pressure support mode. I will show you how a NAVA works apart from this, and it's a better mode than this. Once you see that, you will understand, because it has a positive feedback and it is a better mode. So what is close to physiology, as I have said, the support is proportional to what brain wants, and if your neural inspiratory time and neural expiratory time are same, then we say the ventilation is physiological. How it can be done? Two modes, as I have said, they use this. It uses the electrical signal. Here what it does is, see, it uses the signal, diaphragmatic excitation, electrical signals, and then it stimulates the ventilator. And obviously, as you can understand, as we have to come here, there is an increase in delay, trigger delay. But as we are picking up here, NAVA, the triggering is not by your flow or by your pressure. It is by diaphragmatic electrical signal. So auto peep and leak doesn't affect the NAVA ventilation. It is ideal to pick up this signal. We don't have the technology, but we are advanced now that we pick up the diaphragmatic electrical activity. So how it works? Once we put a catheter which has the electrodes, then it picks up the electrical signals. Then this signal is recorded electrical diaphragm. Then for this, you attach a pressure support. You attach a pressure support, say you get 6 microvolts of electrical activity. You can say, for every microvolt, I want to give 2 centimeters of pressure support. It is again pressure support, but one difference is it is not triggered by your pressure or flow. It is triggered by the electrical activity of the diaphragm. And it translates into a positive relationship between ventilatory assistance and diaphragm patient effort. I'll show you what it is. So if I have a trigger of, the electrical activity signal is 8 microvolts, and if I say I want 2 centimeters of pressure support, this is put as 8, it should be 2 centimeters of pressure support for every microvolt of electrical activity, then I will deliver a pressure support of 16 centimeters. And cycling occurs when the electrical activity starts decreasing to 60 to 70%. That is how studies have proved that normally we tend to change over from inspiration to expiration at that stage. So that is why it has been incorporated at 60 to 70%. So it is a pressure support ventilation, but both triggering and cycling is done by the electrical activity of the diaphragm. And it is as much as the brain wants, because see here, if the demand is more, and this, if the demand is more, if the respiratory drive wants more volume, what does it do? It sends more signal to the diaphragm. So once the diaphragm gets more signal, then it records more signal strength, and the pressure support is increased. Once the patient starts settling down, carbon dioxide comes down, he'll decrease the respiratory drive. So the signals to the diaphragm decreases, and automatically the strength of the electrical signal decreases, and the amount of pressure support decreases. Here it is 8, it is 4. Here is getting 16, here is getting 8 centimeters of pressure support. As I said, 2 centimeters pressure support per microvolt of electrical activity. If he is 8 here, 8 into 2 is 16 centimeters, because the PCO2 was high, pH was low. Here, because of this, patient has become better. Now the electrical signal is less, so the delivered tidal volume, delivered pressure support also is less. This is a positive feedback. This is one mode, which is, we always say, it is brain over the machine. And also one more thing is, diaphragmatic strength signals also tells you, if the signal normally, we have to have about 5 to 6 microvolts. If somebody is having 3 microvolts, you know this patient cannot be weaned. So diaphragmatic strength also tells us the weaning capabilities. Protocolized weaning also is known to occur to increase the weaning chances better, because there are obligated personnel, especially respiratory therapists and physio and nurses who are trained, because we generally, doctors tend to look at the sick patients. If there are two sick patients, we tend to postpone the weaning. So that is goes into delayed weaning. When we have a dedicated protocolized weaning, the team knows what to do, when to wean, what are the set parameters to wean. So, and ABC bundle have been implemented. One of the parts of ABC bundle was awakening and breathing trial. Once you allow that, then there is more concentration towards the patients to be weaned, because there is a separate team and they are not distracted by the sicker patient. So obviously weaning occurs much faster. Then about the automated modes, there are some automated modes. This is what is going to happen with especially diseases like COVID. When teaching has become remote, probably in next 10 years, weaning may be done automatically by the ventilators because of artificial intelligence. See, what is advanced closed loop ventilation is the clinician's brain, intensivist brain has been integrated into the ventilator. Now, what smart care, it is called a smart care, it is there in Dräger ventilation, it is there in so many ventilators, it is there in Hamilton called as Intivent. So what it essentially does is, it measures, there is a protocol, what we generally do with assessing carbon dioxide, tidal volume and rate, and how we set the pressure support increase or decrease has been integrated into the ventilator. So I'll show you how it is done. See, what it does is it measures the respiratory rate, tidal volume and DTCO2. And there is a particular range, like when spontaneously breathing, we tend to keep between 15 to 30, tidal volume should be more than 300 and carbon dioxide should be less than 55. There is a separate algorithm for COPD patients and head injury. Now what it does is, see, if somebody is having a normal tidal volume, normal rate and normal carbon dioxide, what will you do? You will decrease the pressure support by 2 to 4. Suddenly, if you see that the tidal volume is not adequate, or if the ETCO2 is going up, what you will do? You will increase the pressure support by 2 to 4. Similarly, the ventilator does on its own, because the algorithm has been built, the software has been built, it has been told, if the tidal volume goes below this, you increase the pressure support. If it goes above that, you decrease the pressure support. And this is something called as automation, and this is going to be the order of the day in future. And it will generally say when the pressure support is 5 and PEEP is 5, that is fit for TPs and extubation. There is modes like that. So if you have the ventilator which is capable, most of the patients, around 70 to 80% of the patients, can be weaned easily with this kind of modes. So tracheostomy, this is my last slide. Tracheostomy usually done around 7 to 10 days. In COVID, we are advocating to be done after 20 days when the patient becomes negative. So it is not like calendar watching. Tracheostomy cannot be fixed like for this patient for 7 to 10 days. It depends upon the patient. But usually we do it between 7 to 10 days. No evidence that it hastens weaning, but may be helpful in marginal mechanics like COPD. And obviously it helps in patient comfort and cooperation. So the take-home message is, in the acute and stabilization phase, the triad of delirium, ICU-acquired weakness, and VIDD has to be maintained, and that can be mitigated or decreased by a good ABCDEF bundle and a good supportive ICU care. So tomorrow would be readiness testing with the measuring weaning predictors and weaning trials and extubation. See, most of us concentrate here. We don't concentrate at what I have discussed today, but that is also equally important. And for the critical care specialists, so the factors that I have discussed are very, very important. If you don't do that properly, you will fail here. You will fail here, because if you don't do the things properly here, then when you do a jump, it will obviously lead into disaster. That is the bottom line. So we have learned how to do and be safe in this zone. Tomorrow we'll learn how to be safe here also and do the extubation. So thank you. Any questions, we'll take.
Okay, thank you, sir. There were some queries in between, but some actually we'll be dealing tomorrow, like when to start a TPS trial, when to switch over to pressure support.
Yeah, yeah.
And there was a query regarding how and when to see the respiratory driver pressure index on the ventilator.
Tomorrow.
You mentioned it.
See, I want to impress upon them, respiratory drive can be analyzed by looking at P01. What it means, what it is, what are the values, we'll discuss it tomorrow. I want you to understand two things. One, respiratory drive and muscle strength. The combination of the two and how it affects the weaning. That is, what is the today's talk and the mitigation of ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, ICU-acquired weakness, and the third thing is delirium. Yeah.
Another query also, I think we'll be dealing tomorrow, like whether on weaning, we need a chest X-ray before proceeding.
So that is the readiness. See, most of us think that weaning is only readiness testing and extubation. The whole problem doesn't start there. The problem, when you get there, we get stuck because we don't do what we have discussed today. That is the thing what I want to impress upon. You have to do these things properly so that that happens easily. When you jump, you are safe. We'll discuss all that tomorrow.
Basically, we have discussed only parachute.
Yeah, getting ready for
going today. Yeah. Tomorrow we'll jump.
Tomorrow we'll jump.
Okay, sir. Yeah. I'll do the pretest answering, sir. So shall I start my screen share?
Yes, please.
Can you stop share from your side, sir?
Yeah, I can. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Okay, so today onwards, we'll be having some pre-test questions in our Telegram channel. And you can answer that so that we'll come to know how our audience feels about our topic. Second, you will also get an opportunity to refresh before coming for the academic sessions. Okay, yesterday, we had put only three questions. Actually, this is about jumping from with the parachute, the readiness checking, but still I'll go into the answer. Once a patient has been successfully weaned from ventilatory support, the assessment of the airway for extubation would include all the following except. Okay, so what do you want to check? Basically, it's a topic for tomorrow. Out of these options, normal breath sounds is not an indication for assessing the successful weaning. Other things we need to make sure before you start, you decide to pull the tube out. Okay, more details we'll discuss tomorrow. Again, this again unfortunately falls into tomorrow's topic. If the patient fails a spontaneous breathing trial, the clinician should, somewhat related to today's topic, I think, determine the causes of the failure and correct them when possible, because it's all about maintaining the patient in the particular phase, which determines your weaning success. So 74%, we are happy that a good number of people are thinking correctly. Okay. So the last one, patient develops stridor and shortness of breath after extubation. Most appropriate treatment for this problem. So we had a mixed option. Many people believed it's re-intubation. And majority among the attendees, those who have answered, opted for the correct response, aerosolized racemic mixture. Before putting the tube back, make sure you go into the cause.
One addition to this is the decision between re-intubation and aerosol racemic epinephrine would be hypoxemia. If there is a life-threatening hypoxemia, if he had mentioned, I would go with re-intubation. If he has not mentioned, okay, I would go. That is something probably people are confused.
Okay.
Fine. I'm looking at the percentage. 36-35.
Almost close.
Yeah, close.
So this is the problem with the MCQs. The first appropriate treatment for this problem because
not put a this must be box in this,
yeah.
The answer is correct. What you say is correct, but I think that is a critical point you should consider for reintroduction. Yeah.
Okay. Shall I check the chat box? There are no major things. Anybody want to interact?
Go with the questions. Okay. We'll see how they, yeah.
So most of the queries were actually regarding our tomorrow's topic per se.
Yeah, we will answer it. It is better they have raised so many questions. I'll look into it. Okay. I'll see that it will be answered in the talk itself.
Mm-hmm. Sir, can you take us through the case scenarios also? Because I couldn't download it before.
Yeah, why not? It's there on the screen?
No, not yet, sir.
So I have to screen share again. No?
Screen share.
Yeah. Is there?
Yes.
Can anybody say what are the factors that why we are facing a difficult weaning now? Anybody?
So I'll read out the scenario for you. A 65-year-old man admitted with community acquired pneumonia with diabetes, ischemic heart disease, was hypotensive. And he was on 2 inotropes. So respiratory failure, he was placed on ventilator. ARDS was diagnosed. EF was shown to be 35%. It takes 2 weeks for ARDS to resolve and on sedatives, neuromuscular blockers for 48 hours. Nutrition disruptions were frequent. After 2 weeks of repeated attempts to wean, it fails. So why do you think it fails?
What are the factors that could have happened now?
Okay, there are different answers, puns. Heart failure, ARDS not at resolve, IC acquired weakness, ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction, fluid overload, age factor LV dysfunction, critical illness myopathy. So people are punching in a good number of
That's all correct. What they're saying is correct. That's what I want you to understand, that whenever you paralyze somebody, when there is a nutritional disruption, you should be thinking that this guy will go into ICU acquired weakness. Sometimes you can't do. But in those patients, you should know they are difficult to beat. This is what I wanted to impress upon them. That is fine. I would accept all those answers. But one thing you remember, whenever you fail to wean, most of the times, the cause would be cardiac. If the primary disease is corrected, that I'll be discussing heart and weaning tomorrow. But I want you to remember that it is mostly just because I put a EF of 35, it becomes easy. But even with a normal EF before critical illness because of septic myocardiopathy and a lot of issues, the heart might have become from 55 to 40. So that could be one of the factors. So cardiac dysfunction is one of the commonest causes for a difficult wean. That is what you have to remember. Post-operative guy, you can read it out, Sanish.
Yeah. Okay. So this is a different scenario. Previously, it was in case of ARDS. Here we get a post-operative 40-year-old healthy farmer who was operated for a perforated appendix, blood pressure, lower side, 90/60, heart rate, 140 per minute. He's on noradrenaline infusion, operated. So drowsy, muscle power not yet fully reverted. She is shifted to post-op ICU. He started on volume control mode. So post-op ventilation on volume control mode. So which mode you would like to shift him? So noted ready for a weaning mode, BiPAP pressure modes, PSV, CPAP, SAMV.
No SMV. No SMV.
That's what we have been telling. Okay.
No SMV. Pressure control, bi-level, all problem, no SMV.
Okay.
After 2 hours, fully awake, which mode?
Okay. Now, 2 hours elapsed. What's your choice? So, the Guru Prasad says pressure support.
Yeah. And this probably will be kind of a first time readiness testing and extubation, isn't it? This is a guy who is going to go for a easy wean. There won't be much of a problem with this. This is around 70 to 80% of the patients we see in the ICU. That's the reason why we tend to neglect the things which we discussed and get into trouble with the 20%. That is where the real skill of an intensivist, a respiratory therapist, a physiotherapist comes into this thing. Okay. Which are the two proportional modes?
Okay, answers are coming. Nava proportionless ventilation. Okay. Volume support ventilation.
No, volume support ventilation is not a proportional assist. It has a negative feedback. When the patient wants more, it will decrease. So it is not a proportional mode. That you have to remember. We will discuss in detail when we discuss the advanced modes. But you remember like this, that it has a negative feedback. Do they have a proportional assist and NAVA has a positive feedback or a negative feedback?
Okay, fine. They are answering as positive feedback.
Yeah. How can you assess the respiratory drive on a ventilator?
Okay, the answer is coming.
Shall I put it?
Yeah. P0.
Okay, good.
Okay.
How can you estimate the muscle strength on a spontaneous ventilation?
Estimation of muscle strength on spontaneous ventilation.
Pressure support ventilation.
Okay, beam.
The electrical activity of diaphragm, as I said, it gives microvolts. If somebody normally is 5 to 6 microvolts, if somebody has a micro strength of 10 microvolts, then you know this guy is fit for weaning. If he has 2-3 microvolts, you know this guy is not fit for weaning. This is what we will learn tomorrow, pressure muscle index. It is nothing but estimation of a P plateau on a pressure support mode. I'll teach you how to do it and what it indicates, how to know whether it is a good reading or a bad reading. We'll discuss it tomorrow. Because we all think that the set level of pressure is pressure P plat in a pressure support ventilation, isn't it? And in all pressure modes, we always think the attained pressure is the pressure P plat, but it is not. I will tell you why it is not and how to estimate P plat on a pressure support mode. And if you have a gastric balloon, and you can always know the deflections and the diaphragmatic strength. What are the causes of ventilator-induced diaphragmatic dysfunction?
You can start typing your answers now.
Then we'll put up the answers.
Okay. Asynchrony, high PEEP, overdistension by PEEP, prolonged ventilation, hypoventilation, ICU associated weakness, asynchronous.
Yes, all the answers are correct. What is reading, Sanesh, is correct. I put up the...
Okay.
What causes ICU acquired weakness?
Okay. So we'll focus on ICU acquired weakness from now. Steroids, SARS, poor nutrition, steroids, neuromuscular blockers,
hyperglycemia.
Hyperglycemia, vasopressors, less mobilization.
Yes. See here?
Antibiotics.
Some gentamicin, calcium channel blocker, muscle inactivity, hyperglycemia. All the answers are correct. Treatment is nothing but ABCDEF bundle. That is what you have to remember. That is the take-home message today.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions we'll take? Otherwise, we'll wind up.
Okay. So now you can type in your queries. Okay, this video has been live streaming on YouTube. So you will get a recorded version after some time. So you can revise today's lecture through YouTube. The lecture notes also will be uploaded through our Telegram channel. So you can have the lecture notes. If you want, you can watch the video, full lecture again, and you can better prepare for tomorrow's session.
And any queries, any doubts on this?
Dr. Guru Prasad is asking, what's the name of the device for inspiratory muscle training?
It is called inspiratory muscle training. It is, if you type, it is by the Respironics. It is available on Amazon. Guru Prasad, I'll send you the link to your WhatsApp.
Mm-hmm.
That guy is very proactive. He'll buy tomorrow. Start with tomorrow. And in Gadag, in a small town, he does the standard of care is as good as in any city. He maintains the ICU that way.
Okay. There was a request for more explanation on weaning ARDS patients.
We will see tomorrow. Essentially, ARDS weaning is, the crux of ARDS weaning is how you maintain the acute and stabilization phase. This is in ARDS, in sick patients only, it matters what we discussed today. As I said, 40-year-old farmer, organophosphorus, somebody undergoing surgery, just put for a few hours of ventilation, that is all. You don't have to worry at all. They all extubate at the first instance. If you want to do a good ARDS weaning, you have to manage the acute phase and the stabilization phase well, then only the weaning occurs.
Okay, somebody asked for the link to join our Telegram channel. I had put it in the chat. Before this session ends, you can copy and keep, or after you install the Telegram channel. If you are installing Telegram channel for the first time, there will be a verification of your mobile number. After that, you click the link. Your name will be, you will be added as a subscriber to Webinar Critical Care Campus. So we are uploading all the teaching material and handouts into Telegram channel. You will also get all the updates regarding the upcoming program, this week's schedule, and any last minute changes in our program will be updated through Telegram channel. And this week onwards, we'll be having some pre-tests to stimulate you to start reading the topic and prepare in advance for the interactive sessions. So, and some sessions we'll also have live poll, so that we'll come to know among our attendees how many person goes with the option A, B, C, D, and we'll try to find out why this. Okay, if everybody agrees 100% consensus on single option, which is very unlikely in a critical care topic, I think. So anyway, we'll see that. We'll experiment all these interactive platforms and options. Tomorrow, we'll be getting ready to jump out from the flight. So now parachute is ready. So we are all familiarized with the parachute. So those who have got the parachute correctly, know how to deploy, can jump confidently tomorrow. So that's about weaning and extubation. That's the session for tomorrow, right?
Yes. I'll send you the questions tonight to put it in Telegram.
Okay, fine.
Some controversial questions are there.
So that everybody will be stimulated to think, and we'll explore whatever resources we have, be it through online or your books, or consultations with your colleagues. You'll have a better discussion and come out with your choices, and then we can discuss why this, why not that. So we'll have more fruitful discussion. Okay, sir?
Yeah.
So that's all for tonight. Hope you all have copied the invitation link to our Telegram channel, because by the time we disconnect, the chat will disappear. So I think Dr. Anoop is busy with some other program. So we'll catch up tomorrow at 7 p.m. in Webinar Campus. Till then, it's goodbye.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yeah.